I don't think the Advaita Vedanta teachers actually look at it closely enough. I really don't. How does someone stay awake 24 hours a day? And my understanding is, I don't think most of them are. Hello, Abby.
Hello, Vishrant.
Hello.
So I had one of the Advaita Vedanta teachers here this weekend. And of course, I was a little bit interested in the differences of teaching. And he said he had a nice Buddha field and had said many similar things like you do. But there's one difference. He didn't have this understanding of that there's an obstacle in the way. So he said that mind is an illusion and, you know, you're already there and these traditional things, right? So I was wondering, when you started out like an Advaita Vedanta teacher, and then somehow you saw that this is not working, what was it that you saw, and how come these teachers don't see it?
It occurred as a result of reading more and more of Ramana Maharshi, a major Advaita Vedanta teacher of the last century. And what I came across was a teaching that he put out where he talked about who is ready for Advaita Vedanta, who is ready for self-inquiry. And he stated clearly that only those who have done all the meditations, done all the asanas, done all the work on themselves already are really ready, which made me understand that Advaita Vedanta was for people at the end of the line, not for people at the beginning, not for people in the middle, but for people at the end of the line, and mostly for renunciates, people who are prepared to sit in caves or monasteries or ashrams and simply self-inquire. It wasn't suitable for the general public, for lay people who work in the marketplace, who might have a family, who run a house. And so I looked at it and I realized, there's something wrong in all of this. Pure Advaita Vedanta is for renunciates. What works for people in the marketplace is the way of the heart and discipline. The yani path, which is the path of discipline, you've got to get present to what is real, and the bhakti path, which is the path of devotional love. And with these two paths, you can fly because you have two wings. And so you combine them together, and when you do, you start to see that there's obstacles in the way. There are things in the way of you being open. There's things in the way of you perceiving love. And unless you remove those things, you do not perceive love. You might think you do, but you're probably perceiving primal bonding, which is different than love. And so I started to realize that the reason that awakening had occurred here was because I'd been working on myself for 26 years, undoing myself, before awakening occurred. It wasn't a sudden thing. And enlightenment's a sudden thing, and it's an accident that it occurs, but my mind was being prepared for 26 years by me undoing it and removing things that were in the way. Initially, belief systems that were limiting, which was personal growth. I don't think the Advaita Vedanta teachers actually look at it closely enough. I really don't. How does someone stay awake 24 hours a day? And my understanding is, I don't think most of them are. I think they can find awareness, turn awareness onto itself, and then hold satsang, but are they holding that presence because awareness is aware of itself 24 hours a day? Or is it just when they actively turn awareness back to itself and hold satsang? Which is pretty advanced to be able to do that. but it's not home yet. Home is when awareness is aware of itself 24 hours a day, and the one that was looking for enlightenment and the one that turns awareness back to itself is no longer there. It's gone. So I think there's a lot of holes in the Advaita Vedanta business. Someone who can turn awareness on itself can hold presence, but there's a very good chance they can't hold heart because they're not open enough yet. They haven't surrendered enough things yet. And so they give a strong third eye presence and maybe a strong crown presence, but do they have a heart presence? You have to feel it and see.
Yeah. You know, I've asked this stuff before because it's so interesting for me, because when I had my most awake moments, you know, I was sitting with Madhava and I was laughing at him when he said, you know, but there's something you have to do to get there, because in that moment I was there, and it was, it, from that point of view, it looked like everything is perfect. There's nothing we have to do. But now when I'm with you, I'm starting to see that that's like, it looks like it's, I don't know what it is, but it's like I'm fooling myself in some way.
Not really. When awareness is aware of itself through Satori, you're home. That is home. And everything feels perfect. That's exactly how it feels when you're home. But if the mind hasn't been prepared to support what is found by not contracting to anything that comes its way, well, you're going to go back, because awareness is going to pull away for itself from itself and go back to the mind, which is what it does. And then a person feels, well, I've lost what I found. And they have it to some degree. Not that it went anywhere, but awareness is no longer aware of itself. It's aware of the mind. And so you're back to ego-based reality rather than being-based reality. And the difference is huge. It's like heaven and hell.
Yeah, but when awareness is aware of itself, is it not possible to see this, or is it just inexperience?
The first tutorials I had, I thought I was awake. And I thought I was awake for quite a while, but I wasn't. My mind was just holding it in memory to some degree. And there was some kind of presence as a result of the stories. It wasn't for another, 11 years before full awakening occurred, as a result of myself as an I, giving myself completely to truth or God, whatever you want to call it, unconditional surrender. Everything for God and nothing for me as an I. And that's the only deal in town. There is no other deal. Before that deal, I made another deal, and that deal was everything for heart and nothing for me. And that was a very beautiful deal. Because of that, I refused to close for any reason whatsoever, because it would cut me off from the perception of heart, and I felt that was a betrayal of heart. And so I removed everything that closed me so I could perceive love and operate in the world from that love, which basically meant taking care of everybody I met, because that's how love affects the mind. You just want to take care of everybody. And that's a very beautiful way to live. And I was living that way for quite a long time before enlightenment.
Thank you.
See, looking at everything from where I am right now, I am everything, and everything is God. Everything is truth. Nothing needs to be done. It's all perfection upon perfection upon perfection. But then I realize there's people in the room and people online who are still suffering, thinking they're not at home, because awareness is not on awareness in them. And out of love, I talk.